Sing one more. एक लहान म्हणा आधी वाच बर लहान आहे
Yeah.
There's no place for you to sit somewhere, so. May I request all the Sahajogis to go out of the hall, where there are many waiting outside, so it's better to give them room. Please. I think tu mala sarana gaava lagel bahera. समोरच्या खुर्च्या आहेत थोड्याशा. You have to tell them outside that we have made room for you, please come. I'm sorry, you have to get out of the hall because we are not allowed to have more people here. I bow to all the seekers of truth. At the very outset, we have to know what is the truth. There are so many seekers of truth in these modern times, which has been predicted that there will be many people who will be seeking the truth now as ordinary households. Their life will be completely transformed in these modern times. They call it in the Quran as Qiyamah. In the Bible, it's called as the Last Judgment. Every religion has talked about these modern times as something very fantastic, that our lives will be transformed. So what is the truth we are seeking? We should know what is the truth we are seeking. Firstly, we are seeking peace within ourselves. Secondly, we are seeking something we do not know, and that something is the spirit within ourselves. Many scriptures have described that you have to seek your spirit, and many are preaching about it, but it seems they are not very spirit-oriented. They are more money-oriented or power-oriented. And that is why the whole attention of a seeker is diverted and deviated into something which is not really divine. So what we are seeking is the spirit within us, which is the source of absolute truth, absolute joy, and absolute self-knowledge. You have already heard about these different centers that are within us, which are being built during our evolution as human beings. We have reached up to a point, but still we have to have the last breakthrough in our awareness. Otherwise, we cannot know the truth. At this human awareness, it is impossible to know the absolute truth. If we had known the absolute truth, there would have been no problem. Everybody would have seen the same thing. But there are so many ideologies. As you know, there are so many religions, so many types of preachings, and also lots of false people. So if we know the absolute truth, then there cannot be another truth with it. It's singular. For example, I'm sitting before you. You know I'm sitting before you, all of you. There's no argument on that one. In the same way, we have to know. Please come in, please. This room here. Wherever is the room, can you lift your hand so that they can come? Just come here. I'm sorry you had to wait. There's seats here in front also. All right, here also we have, you could come that way. I'm sorry, the hall has fallen short. Here is, yeah. Come in.
Just here.
They've got seats
there. We have to have now the last breakthrough of our revolution. Once it happens, you will be amazed that we know the absolute truth. There cannot be any argument about it. And also, these centers that you know here are a mystery to you, but you start feeling them on your fingertips. That is self-knowledge. These centers are responsible for your physical, mental, emotional, also spiritual being within yourself. So all your personality, the totality of it, is expressed through these centers. These are subtle centers within us, and these subtle centers are sometimes exhausted because of our extreme nature. So this power, which we call as Kundalini, Kundala means coils, which is in 3.5 coils within us. In the sacrum bone, that means the Greek knew that it was a sacred bone, they call it sacrum. This power is actually your individual mother, and she knows everything about you. She knows about your past, and she knows about your aspirations. It's like a tape recording, I should say, of ages within you in this coiled power. It is like a prenup of a seed. When you put the seed in the Mother Earth, then it sprouts by itself, spontaneously. That is what is sahaja. It's all built in within you. And you have every right to achieve this state of selfhood, which is in the fourth dimension of your awareness, which we in Sanskrit call as Turiya, is the fourth dimension. All this is within you, all this power is within you. You are built in that way. We have to understand that our Creator is the greatest organizer. See, now we have one channel here for people to come in. This is the channel which we have very nicely built up within ourselves, which in our evolutionary process has enlightened all these centers up to a point. Now this Kundalini, this power has to rise. I've read some books, some German books and things, where it is described that this Kundalini awakening is extremely dangerous, and it kills people, is fatal, nothing of the kind. I've been doing this for the last 25 years. I never saw anybody getting sick. But on the contrary, this awakening is so beneficial, so benevolent, that when this power passes through all these six centers and pierces through this last center out of the fontanelle bone area, which we can call the actualization of baptism, actualization, then all these centers get enlightened, enriched, and this nourishment solves your physical, mental, emotional and spiritual problems. So the first truth about yourself is that you are not this body, this mind, these emotions, this intellect, this ego, these conditions, but you are the pure spirit. Now we see all these beautiful flowers around us, and we take them for granted. It's a miracle that these different flowers have bloomed out of a seed in their own different identity. Who has done this work? Who changes the seasons? Or if you ask a doctor, who runs your heart? He'll say, it is autonomous nervous system. But who is this auto? These questions and many others cannot be answered. So there is an all-pervading power of divine love, which is doing all these miraculous things. Now you need not take for granted whatever I am telling you. We have had lots of problems with blind faith. But whatever I am saying, if it is true, then as honest people you must accept. Not only accept, but grow in your new awareness. Of course, you must understand you can't pay for it. How much did we pay to become human beings, and how much are we going to pay for becoming something higher? Once you realize that you can't pay for it, then you will drop out. Most of the false gurus and the false institutions who charge you for anything like that. Now this happening is very simple, spontaneous, works out. As I said, it's like a premium of a seed. This kundalini, when you put the seed in the mother earth, it sprouts by itself. In the same way it works. You can't explain, can you explain how a seed sprouts? In the same way, your premium, which is this kundalini, uncoils itself and passes through these centers and gives you your self-realization. In Sanskrit it's called as Atma Sakshatkar. For you, it is absolutely granted. You don't have to go to Himalayas, you don't have to stand on your heads, you don't have to starve yourself, don't have to pay for it. It is all there, which is your own power. Only when it happens, you realize your identity. You realize how great you are. You realize how the divine is within you and which is expressing itself. With all these false things that are going on, for example, somebody can say that I am a twice born. Now, if somebody is a twice born person, then he must have some powers. He must have some speciality. He must have some sort of understanding, compassion. And the compassion should act. But just by certifying yourself as something, you do not become. The certificate has to come from your kundalini. She has to give you your second birth, and she is very anxious to do it. So now we come to the point that people who are seeking the divine go to various religions. I have nothing to say against religions as such. But just take Christian religion. It's a very difficult religion to follow. Because Christ has said, if your one eye does anything wrong, take it out. If your one hand does something wrong, cut it out. Have you met anybody like that who has cut his hand or who has taken out your eyes? I've been to all the countries in the West and all over who call themselves Christians. I haven't seen one person who does that. That means they just brand themselves. Christ was a great incarnation, very pure. And I think he never understood human beings, what sort of people they are. He thought they were all angels. And he gave all these rules and regulations for angels, that if the angels make mistake, they should suffer. But you, we are all normal human beings. We can't do like this. Then you take to, say, Muhammad Sahib's teaching. He just thought that Christ was so strict with men, why not try with women also? And he said, of course, apart from other things, that women, if they have a bad eye on some other man than her husband, then she should be buried in the Mother Earth halfway and should be stoned. I mean, just imagine. I was thinking about American women, what would happen to them if this kind of thing going on, because the divorce laws are so good for them that they are divorcing all the time. Their husbands and doing all kinds of things, they don't know that this is what is according to Islam. And the Sharia that they talk of also was given by Moses to the decadent society of Jews when he came all the way and brought those 10 commandments. He saw these people so decadent that he thought it's better to give a very, very strict laws to them, to save them. So he said, you cut their hands if they do any thieving. All kinds of horrible things. It's on the Jeremiah. If you read that, it's in the Bible. It's written by Jeremiah, what Moses told the Jews. I think the Jews didn't like all that. So they gave it up. And Muhammad Sahib took it over, that this should be allowed only among Islamic people. It's terrible. And all this, when you see, you find that we have to first arrive at a point where we understand them, where we can follow them. And for that, you have to have your self-knowledge. You must know yourself. Christ has said, know thyself. Another problem is that in the Bible, there's a description of the Father, the God, Son, the God, and the Mother is missing. She is a Holy Ghost and a dove. I don't know how can you connect it to it. There has to be a Mother. There has to be primordial Mother. Who is the one who is responsible for looking after this creation? And the God Almighty is just the witness of the whole show. This primordial Mother, the Holy Ghost, is reflected in you as the Kundalini. While the Spirit is the reflection of God Almighty in your heart. Now the time has come to prove all these things. It is going to be the actualization of experience of your spirit. It's not just talking, giving a sermon, but actually it is going to happen. And when it happens, you must respect it. As I told you, the spirit is the source of absolute knowledge. Absolute truth. Because if you put your hands after realization towards anybody, you will immediately know what centers he's catching. You will not see his clothes, you will not see his dress or anything, but you will see the inner being on your fingertips. You can feel it. And you will immediately know what's the problem of the gentleman. In the same way, you will know about yourself. What is the problem? What centers are in trouble? because centers are the fundamentals of our personality. So once you know what's wrong with another person, and also you know how to correct it, you can help that person physically, mentally, emotionally, and spiritually. But of course, I must say that it doesn't work for people who are idiots or stupid. You'll be amazed that I've met a number of them, and I was amazed that how they are so educated, have so many degrees, and so idiotic. Too much lost in their own thoughts that they are very great people, and they are not willing to accept anything that is sensible. Also, for people who are extremely arrogant and critical, the Kundalini doesn't rise. I have seen such people take a lot of time. But on the whole, in Russia, my experience has been that always there have been people, more than 16,000 in any program I was there. They are so sensitive, not that they get their realization, but they settle down with it. They are like clean slate, they have no conditioning. They just, I don't know how, they just are waiting for the real truth and they get it. What happens that our thoughts, which are always hovering on our mind from the past and the future, all these thoughts keep us jumping on the cusp. We cannot enter into the present. The present doesn't exist for us. All the time these thoughts start moving in such a manner that this mind is restless. But when Kundalini rises, he elongates those thoughts. Like a thought rises, falls, another thought rises and falls. When the Kundalini rises, she elongates them and creates a space in between that is the present. At that time, you don't have any thoughts. You are in thoughtless awareness. You are extremely aware, but you are thoughtless. That is the present. In the present, you are absolutely without any thoughts. Supposing I say, please don't think, you can't do that. If I say, please go into your present, you can't. It's only possible when the Kundalini rises, automatically you become thoughtlessly aware. And that is the time you are at peace with yourself. You are enjoying the peace within yourself. And also you emit peace. Wherever such a person goes, he emits peace because he's so relaxed and his whole being is emitting that peaceful personality. I have seen people who have got awards in peace, and some of them have got big organization of peace and all sorts of things, but they are very hot tempered. Extremely hot tempered, some of them you have to approach with a barge pole. So how can they create peace anywhere? I can't understand how they got the award, from which angle. But there are people who are having big organizations of peace. It is a human being who has to individually become peaceful so that the whole lot, the collective, becomes peaceful. Now we have Sahaja Yoga working 65 nations, and I get people in India for a seminar, supposing, from all these nations, selected people. I've never seen them quarreling, fighting, but such fun, such enjoyment of friendship. There's no race, there is no country, nothing. They have sort of gone beyond all this, and they are enjoying each other in such a manner. This is your own, is a birthright for you to have, is within you and you can get it. No problem on that. But only thing is that you have to have earnest desire, the pure desire. This Kundalini is the power of pure desire within us. All other mundane desires are, as you know, are not satiable in general. That shows that they are not pure. Today we want to have a house, and then we want to have a car, then we want to have a helicopter, then an aeroplane, I don't know what else. We never enjoy whatever we wish for. So this pure desire is something else, and that is to become one with this all-pervading divine power of love. Whether you know it or not, whether you are aware of it or not, it is so. So now, this power is within you and is absolutely in perfect condition. You'll be amazed, the innocence that we have is never lost. It is sometimes clouded, but these clouds also get absolutely cleared out. And really we become a very innocent personality, radiant with divinity. It's like a lamp, or you can say a candle. You can enlighten a candle with another candle which is enlightened. And this can go on. This is how it is, because the time has come, and I call it the blossom time. I think there are many flowers who are born as seekers of truth, and they have to become now fruits. And they do become, believe me, it's true. For example, if I say many physical problems can be solved, people don't believe it. Without any money, without any medicine, by your own power. But in Delhi, there are three doctors who have got their MD for curing people of their incurable diseases through surgery. But when it will be accepted in this country also, we can show how it works. But I think is something so simple is to raise this kundalini and to nourish and enlighten your centers. That's all one has to do. Even you need not be a doctor, you can also cure people. People don't believe what powers they have. There's such a big desire to have an identity. But the identity lies within yourself, not outside. For example, you can find clubs of any kind, cults of any kind. They wear funny dresses just to show that they have a special personality. The other day in Chicago, it was very cold, and I found a gentleman who came as one leader of one of the cults. He was chanting like mad. I asked him, why are you wearing this dhoti? In this cold, it's so very cold, we are shivering. Oh, he said that my guru has told me that I should wear a dhoti, so I'll get my self-realization. I said, really? I said, 80% people in India wear dhotis, or they must be already there. You may not get any room there. Then second thing he told me, he shed shaven his head and was having some pigtail behind. And he says that, I told him, why did you do this? Quite a young man. He said, my guru has told that I have to shave my head and I have to have all these things. That's how I'll get my nirvana. I said, really? So Kabir, a great poet, has written that by shaving, if you can go to heaven, what about the lamb which is shaved twice a year? That will be there earlier. So like this, you see, all kinds of stupid things have been told and people have been following it. I don't know, in the West especially, people are very vulnerable. I don't know why. Not in India, you see, it's difficult. People are solidly grounded, I think, in their tradition. For example now, if they say skirt which is 6 inches is in fashion, everybody will start wearing 6 inches skirts. All the long skirts will vanish from the market, and what you find, all of them wearing 6 inches skirt. But in India, they brought some mini sari. They said, get lost, we don't want all this nonsense here. You see, it's too much for us, we are not. So like this, you see, we take to these entrepreneurs and things. It's sometimes so absurd, I don't know how people accept all this nonsense. But I feel that once they develop their own being and understand how great they are, then they will have a proper divine discretion to do things which are very constructive. Normally we take to destructive things, but with this discretion we do constructive things, not for ourselves only, but for the benevolence of our family, for the benevolence of our city, and for the benevolence of the whole world. This is a special time, as I told you, very important, when you should not miss it out. So in our awareness, we have a new dimension, which I call as collective consciousness, where you can feel others and you can feel yourself. You don't have to judge a person by his dress, by his gait, by his talk, but his divine vibrations. You will know that what sort of chakras he has, what sort of centers he has. And thus, once you know what is wrong with him, you can, after certain development in you, you can cure yourself and can cure him. So, the second thing, apart from the thoughtless awareness, is that you become doubtlessly aware. Doubtless, there's no doubt. Once you have learnt it, once you are an expert, you have no doubts about it. You understand what you are, what you are capable of, and what you can achieve. There are no doubts left. So the second stage, some people get both the stages together. I've seen there have been so many seekers that they just get two doubtless awareness. But doesn't matter, it takes time for some people. Some people may not get realization if they are, I would say, not well, or maybe there's something, they have been to some wrong people. Also maybe that they are doubting something, doubting themselves. So the first and foremost understanding should be that you are all capable of achieving this. You shouldn't doubt yourself. You must really respect yourself, because you are a human being at the epitome of evolution. You are the highest. We have nothing to learn from birds or from dogs, but we have to know that we can ourselves become so sensitive that we'll understand nature, we'll understand animals, everything we start understanding. The sign of a Sahayogi, that he's absolutely honest, is very kind, tender, and compassionate. This is the minimum of minimum a Sahayogi has to be. Of course, because the door is open, sometimes some mad people also walk in. Can't help it. But most of the people who are taking to Sahayoga, I was amazed, are so much changed. They had dropped all their bad habits. I never tell that. Supposing I say, don't do this, half of the people will walk off. Just I say, get the light of the spirit within yourself. Then you become your own master. Then you become your own guide. And you understand what is right for you, what is good for you, and what is to be done. There is no rule or regulation like don't in such way. But automatically, you all accept it and do it together collectively also. It is very remarkable that it has worked so well also in Australia. Australia is a special country. I call it a country of innocence. Uluru that you have is the symbol of that. Gradually in Sahayoga, you will learn about your country and you respect it. As you learn about yourself, you'll also learn about this great country of Australia. I respect it very much, and every year I try to come here. Many countries I can't go every year, but Australia, I always try to come here every year. I hope you all will get your self-realization tonight. Now, only request is that it will take hardly 10-15 minutes. But if you want to go, you can go now, and don't disturb people when they are about to get their self-realization. I'll be thankful for that. Thank you very much.
There are seats here also. There are Sahayogis who are standing there. You can come in, there is room. Please. Please be seated. Of course, there are three conditions which are very simple, not difficult, if you understand the importance of self-realization. First condition is that you are not to feel guilty. It's a fashion also, to feel guilty is a fashion. And it goes too far sometimes, and it affects the left side of the center here, left side, which is very dangerous, because it causes spondylitis, also angina, also cervical cancer, also it causes imbalance, or we can say the weakening of the organs, lethargic organs. With all this, why should we feel guilty? If you have done any mistakes, you should have faced it at that time and finished. No use feeling guilty now about something which you did in the past. I said you have to be in the present, because the past doesn't exist. Future it doesn't exist either. So what exists is the present. At this moment, I would request you not to feel guilty at all. You have to respect yourself. We have no right to degrade ourselves for nothing at all. This human life is very precious and also worthy of respect. So you forgive yourself fully. The second condition is very important, is to forgive everyone without thinking about them, because even thinking about them is a headache. Now there's a center on our optic chiasma, which we call as the agya, is just like this, constricted, absolutely constricted. And if you don't forgive, it won't open. If it won't open, then how can Kundalini pass through? By not forgiving others, you have played into wrong hands. Because whether you forgive or don't forgive, you don't do anything. But you play into the hands of people who have troubled you, while they are enjoying themselves. So what's the use of not forgiving? Firstly, it's so important to get your self-realization. All your life you have tortured yourself, now at least forgive. Forgive everyone, don't think of them even, just forgive from your heart. The third condition is very simple, is that you have to take out your shoes, because this Mother Earth helps us a lot. I'm sorry, I must tell you, first time in England when I said take out your shoes, half of them walked out. I mean, it's such a serious crime to take out shoes. But now it's different, very different. this Mother Earth is very helpful for us. And also, without shoes, our feet are more comfortable. Now, there are two powers, left and right. The left stands or works for our desires, mundane desires, and the right for our action. So we put our left hand on our lap, like this, towards me, which is symbolic that you are desirous of having your self-realization. The second thing is that we have to nourish our centers. We work it out only on the left-hand side with our right hand, which is for action. So we put our right hand on our different centers. We show you, first of all, we put our right hand, first we put both the feet apart from each other because they are two powers. And now put our right hand on our heart. In the heart resides, inside the coat, take your hand inside, resides the spirit, as I told. If you become the spirit, you become your guide, you become your own master. So we take our hand onto the upper portion of our abdomen and press it hard. This is the center for our mastery. We now take our hand in the lower portion of our abdomen under left hand side and press it. This is the center which is surprisingly for pure divine knowledge. You know that later on everything can be verified. In Sahaja Yoga, everything can be verified. Nothing is hidden, no secrets. Everything can be verified now. Take your right hand now into the upper portion of your abdomen on the left hand side. Then you have to take your right hand in there, on top of your heart. Now in the corner of your neck and shoulder, as I told you, and turn your head to your right, as I told you, that this center, if it catches, it creates problems for you. Now we take our right hand on top of our forehead across and bend our head as far as possible. This is the center to forgive everyone. Now take back your right hand on the back side of your head and push back your head. Here, without feeling guilty, without counting your mistakes, you have to ask forgiveness from the divine power. Now, the last center is important. Stretch your hand as much as possible. Stretch your palm. And the center of your palm, you put it on the fontanel bone area, which was a soft bone in your childhood. Now please put down your head as far as possible. Push back your fingers. This is very important. Push back your fingers so there's a good pressure on the scalp. And now move your scalp 7 times slowly clockwise. Bend your heads, please. Push back your fingers, push back your fingers. 7 times, that's all we have to do. Now we have to close our eyes. Take down your hands, please. We have to close our eyes and do the same thing as I've shown you. I would request you to take out your glasses if possible, because it helps for eyesight also. Now again, please put both the feet apart from each other. Put the left hand on your lap like this, and put your right hand on your heart. Now please close your eyes, not tightly, but just as we do it when we sleep. Now, please close your eyes. You are not to open your eyes till I tell you. So please keep your eyes closed. Please put your right hand on your heart. And now you have to ask a very fundamental question about yourself in your heart. Please ask three times. You can call me Mother, or you can call me Shri Mataji. Mother, am I the Spirit? Ask this three times. Mother, am I the Spirit? Ask three times. I have told you that when you become the Spirit, you become your own guide, your own master in the light of the Spirit. So now please take your right hand, the upper portion of your abdomen, and press it hard on the left hand side. Here again, you have to ask another fundamental question about yourself three times in your heart. Mother, am I my own master? Ask this question three times. Mother, am I my own master? Or Mother, am I my own guru? Ask this question three times. Now I must confess that I cannot force on you the divine knowledge. Because I respect your freedom, you have to ask for it. So now take down your right hand into the low portion of your abdomen on the left hand side. And here you ask six times, because this center has got six petals. In your heart, please ask for divine knowledge. Mother, please give me pure divine knowledge. Just say it six times. As soon as you ask for pure divine knowledge, the Kundalini starts moving by itself. So we have to nourish our higher centers with our full self-confidence. Now please take your right hand in the upper portion of your abdomen on the left hand side. Here you have to say with full self-confidence 10 times, Mother, I am my own master. Now, I have already told you at the very outset that you are not this body, this mind, this intellect, these emotions, this ego and conditionings, but you are the pure Spirit. So now raise your right hand on your heart. And here you have to say it 12 times with full confidence in your heart. Mother, I am the pure Spirit. This divine power is the ocean of knowledge. It's the ocean of miracles, ocean of bliss and compassion. But above all, it is the ocean of forgiveness. And whatever mistakes you might commit, this ocean of forgiveness can dissolve it. So please forgive yourself and put your right hand in the corner of your neck and shoulder and turn your head to your right. Here you have to say 16 times, Mother, I am not guilty at all. Say it with full confidence, 16 times. I find this center in a great jeopardy in the West. I don't know why people feel guilty for what. I have already told you whether you forgive or don't forgive, you don't do anything. But if you don't forgive, you play into wrong hands and torture yourself. Especially at this moment, you have to forgive everyone without thinking about them. Because if you don't forgive, the center of Agya won't open, which is very constricted, and you will miss your self-realization. So now raise your right hand on top of your forehead across and put your head down. Put your head down as far as possible. Here, you have to say, Mother, I forgive everyone. Say it from your heart, not how many times. Please say it from your heart. Mother, it's very important. I forgive everyone. Now don't think about them. Mother, I forgive all of them in general. Now take back your right hand on the back side of your head. And put your head upward. Here, without feeling guilty, without counting your mistakes, you have to again say from your heart, not how many times, O Divine Power, if I have done any mistakes knowingly or unknowingly, please forgive me. You have to ask for forgiveness without feeling guilty, without counting your mistakes. You have to say this just for your satisfaction. O Divine Power, if I have done any mistakes, knowingly or unknowingly, please forgive me. Say it from your heart, please. Now, the last center is most important. Please stretch your palm fully. And put the center of your palm on top of your head, on the fontanel bone area, which was the soft bone in your childhood. Now please put down your head as far as possible. You have to stretch your fingers to have a good pressure on your scalp. Here again, I respect your freedom and self-realization cannot be forced on you. So you have to ask for it. So now, please put down your heads, stretch back your fingers, move your scalp 7 times. Slowly, clockwise, saying, Mother, give me my self-realization. Thank you. Now please take down your hands, sit erect, and open your eyes slowly. Please. Put both the hands towards me like this. Now, put the right hand little further and bend your head and see with the left hand if there's a cool breeze coming out of your fontanel bone area. It could be hot. Also, if you have not forgiven, it would be hot. So please put down your head and see for yourself if there is a cool or a hot breeze coming out of your head. It may be very close to your head, could be far away. So move your hand a little bit. Please bend your head. That's the best way you get the results. Now, put the left hand towards me. Again, with the right hand you see for yourself, bend your head. See for yourself if there's a cool breeze of the Holy Ghost is coming out or not. It could be hot, I told you, if you have not forgiven. So please forgive yourself and forgive others, so it will cool down. Now again, put your right hand towards me once again and see with your left hand if there's a cool or a hot breeze coming out of your own fontanel bone area. Move your hand and see for yourself. Now, please put both your hands towards the ceiling like this and push back your head. Now ask out of these three questions, any one of these three questions, three times. Mother, is this the cool breeze of the Holy Ghost? Mother, is this the all-pervading power of divine love? Or, Mother, is this the Param Chaitanya, which is Rupa? Any one of these questions you can ask three times in your heart. Put down your hands, please. Put the hands again like this. And watch me without thinking. Just watch me without thinking. Some people get it coming from down below, so you can take it out like that, if some people get it like that also. Don't think. Watch me without thinking, please. You can do it. That's the present. All those who have felt cool or hot breeze on their fingertips or in their palms or out of their fontanel bone area, please raise your both the hands. My goodness. May God bless you, the whole of Sydney. I bow to you. You have entered into saintly lives. Respect it. I really bow to all of you. May God bless you. Thank you very much. Some have not felt, very few. They should really come to our programs. Also those who have felt should definitely come to our programs where you will learn everything about Sahaja Yoga. You can master it and you can become really part and parcel of the whole. You'll be surprised how it works. It has worked already. It's the first time you have felt the cool breeze or the hot breeze from your forehead and also from your fontanel bone area and also in your hands. For the first time you have felt the all-pervading divine power of love, which protects, which guides, which loves and nourishes us. May God bless you all. Thank you very much. சொல்ல.
Will be follow-up programs to be held this Thursday, the 23rd of February at 7:30, and then again on Wednesday, the 1st of March at 7:30, both at the YWCA, Wentworth Avenue.